And welcome on board with myself, Scott. Phil's on camera with me this morning. And it's a beautiful, beautiful morning. It's very cold relative to the last few mornings we've been having out here. That's why I've got my beanie on. And we've been warmed up with the prospects of finding some lions. They've lion tracks that have been walking down this road. We've been following them for just over a mile now. They've been zigzagging onto different roads. And we're hoping to find them. We have just driven past some impala though, and they were standing right on the side of the road that the lion had walked past. So that will help us to assume that the lions have moved a fair time ago, because these impala were very relaxed. They could be lying up nearby though, and I hope that's the case. Now, this morning we're going to have a new presenter trying out. And his name is Byron, and you'll all meet him shortly. He's a great guide, and I hope you all welcome him and send him through lots of questions and enjoy his safari that he takes you on. So there's Byron and Andrew out on another vehicle. And for those of you who may be joining for the first time, again, my name is Scott, and it's important to know that this is a live safari. This is happening this very second, and not only is it live, but it's also interactive. So if you would like to ask either myself or Byron, the other presenter, any questions, it's really easy. You just hashtag Safari Live on Twitter or send an email through to questions@wildearth.tv. Oh, look at this. This is beautiful. There's a saddle-billed stork flying past. Really pretty bird. And it's really big as well. And it could have just taken off from the Juma Dam, which has a live waterhole camera. We did go past the Juma waterhole a little bit earlier, because the lion tracks were up and down in and around that area. But they ended up veering more north, so that's where we followed them to. We're on Impala Plains now. And a few other important members of our team who are also up and about this morning are Nikki and Eugene in the final control. So, without further ado, like I said, the lion's tracks are heading straight down this road. We are quite close to our boundary with Arethusa, but thankfully we are allowed onto Arethusa. So even if these lions do cross, oh, they've all been sleeping here. And I'm actually going to stop and show you. There's a huge amount of lion tracks, and you can actually see where some of their tails were lying in the ground. Look at all those lion tracks. If we go further to the right, we'll see a few marks where, if you could zoom out a bit, there we go. Over here is where the tail of a lion, you can see that, almost imagine the tail and the little black furry fur ball at the end creating that larger depression in the sand. So these lions took a break here, but I'm sure would have continued down this road after their small snooze. Enjoyed seeing all of those tracks, and I wonder who it is, possibly the Inkahuma pride, but we can never be sure until we actually find the animals. What have their tracks done from here? They appear to continue down this road, so will we. Much fun tracking any animal, but can often lead us in a wild goose chase, but that's half the fun. If the animals had tracking devices on them, our job would not be nearly as exciting as it is. In some regards, it would be easier just being able to drive straight to these animals that can be hard to find. not get too excited, which is often the case. And even just back there, I stopped looking at the road for a few seconds. And now the tracks appear to have disappeared off the road. Lions and leopards will use the roads as much as they can, because just like us humans using a freeway or a highway, it's the path of least resistance. But highways will only take you into a general area that you'd like to be, not exactly where you'd like to be. So they then will use smaller pathways once the highways no longer take them in the right general direction. And I'm guessing that's what could have happened here. They could have veered off to the west, which has been their general direction. So I'm just going to check this boundary road here and see if they have in fact crossed. I'm guessing we are going to find their tracks on this road here. You know exactly the temperature we are feeling here. As I said, it was cold a little bit earlier. It's apparently 10 degrees Celsius, which is about 51 degrees Fahrenheit, and that is, I'm sure, true. But what we do have to factor into that equation is that wind chill factor from driving on an open vehicle drops the temperature considerably by about 3 or 4 degrees Celsius, so depending on how fast you're going. So that does emphasize the weather and cool temperatures we are experiencing. I guess everything is relative. It's cold for us, but for a lot of you, the viewers all around the world, you may be in a lot colder climates than us at the moment. Continue searching for these lions, but Byron would like to introduce himself to all of you. And like I said, it's his first drive out here, so there's a lot going through his head, and I'm sure you'll all be welcoming to him and send him through lots of questions to make his morning as easy as possible. Enjoy, and we'll see you later.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Juma. My name is Byron, and I'm going to be your guide for today. We are sitting at the old hyena den at the moment, and as you can see behind me, there is an adult and has been resting here this morning. We had a very interesting moment as we arrived here. We noticed something actually coming out the burrow, and on closer inspection, we saw that it was in fact a warthog, which is very strange for us. The hyena has been lying probably about I'd say 20 to 30 meters away, and the warthog stuck its head out, looked like an adult female, and she sat for a short period of time watching, scanning the area, making sure that there wasn't any danger around, and after about 5 minutes she stood up and ran out of the burrow. This is actually very strange behavior. I've never seen this before, and I understand that this burrow was in fact active, or this den rather, was active a few days ago. So it would be interesting to find out if the pups are, or the cubs, excuse me, are still in the den. It's quite unlikely for warthog to go into a burrow or a den site if there are other animals around. I haven't heard of that type of interaction before. Unless what can occasionally happen is there may be two entrances to this den, and perhaps the cubs are on the other side in another hole. Occasionally it may link up, but perhaps they are hidden on the other side, and the warthog slept in the den during the evening, and now I've gone off to feed for the day and spend the day outside. This hyena over here is not fazed by us at all, completely relaxed. Just resting, possibly been moving around during the evening, trying to see if it could pick up on the smell or the scent of any kill. And now has returned back to the den. It may have just checked that the cubs are okay and is resting for a while. You know, a lot of these animals are very active at night and can cover quite a large distance. So we don't really know what this hyena got up to, but I'm sure it did cover quite a bit of ground and is now just resting and relaxing. It's so exciting to be here for me. I haven't been in this Juma area for quite a number of years. I'm sure a lot of you are curious about a bit of my background and why I'm here today. So I have worked in the Sabi Sands for many years. It's such a wonderful place to be and always great to come back. Been away for a little while, and now fortunately I get to take you around and show you some of this beautiful area. Oh, leopard. Oh, hang on. We've got a leopard. It looks like, it's moving directly behind the hyena, probably 40 meters away. Oh, this is exciting stuff. Hyena's up and running. Okay, what I'm going to do is I'm going to quickly try to see if we can follow this. So the leopard has just run off away from this area, but it looked as if it was quite nervous and skittish. Could possibly have spotted our hyena, and a lot of the time leopards don't like too much attention drawn to them. Let me see if I can find this leopard again. Move through quite a thick area. Let's have a look at. This is very exciting stuff. The hyena's running around. We've got the leopard again. It's moving through a thicket, and the hyena's chased him off. Let me see. It's a bit tricky to try to get through here now. As I was saying, the leopard obviously doesn't want any attention drawn to it, and this hyena ran straight after the leopard, possibly also trying to get it away from the den site. Quite a big drainage line in between me and where the leopard has gone, so it's going to be difficult to try and follow from here for now. Let's see if I can make my way around somewhere. I've struggled to get a position. dominant leopard, which is a dominant leopard on the Arethusa area, so not actually seen very often on Juma. There's the wonderful thing about leopard is that they can cover a huge, huge territory, sometimes bigger than what you would expect. us a sign that they've seen a predator, like a leopard or a hyena. Good morning to Oki, who just sent us a question on Twitter. And you asked if the hyena is dangerous to people. Definitely. A hyena is an extremely powerful, powerful predator. They, in most parts of southern Africa, hyenas tend to scavenge a lot more than hunt for themselves. But they do hunt a lot of the time, especially up in East Africa. They a lot of the predator density isn't very high in certain areas. So the hyenas do have to hunt for themselves so that they can get food. Hyenas generally would be quite skittish. They're very curious animals, but they are skittish. So they may come, have a closer look, sniff around. But if you clap your hands or make a noise, they may run away from you. However, if you corner a hyena or try and take food from them, then you are definitely looking for trouble, and they can be dangerous to people. They've got the most powerful jaws out of any predator in this area, so their crushing strength is incredible. They're fascinating animals. They really are. Just trying to listen out a little bit more for any signs. We don't hear anything currently. Again, with that hyena running after the leopard, because the leopard is a solitary predator, they don't want to risk any injury. If they get injured, they won't have the opportunity to hunt for themselves and possibly cause death. So a leopard tries to avoid any other predators. Just some Franklin calling in the drainage line, but it sounds more like just a morning call rather than a distress or alarm call. As I was saying, that a leopard doesn't want to risk any chance of injury. So avoiding any other predators is key for the leopard. They would prefer to run up a tree or disappear into a drainage line than stand and face a hyena. Even though the hyena would not be hunting the leopard, but often hyena follow leopard to see if they perhaps have a kill, which they may steal from them. Line now. It's if you see it's quite steep down here, so it's very difficult to try get a vehicle down there. But again, a perfect little area for a leopard to run and hide away. Hyena around.
around.
These are very, very clever animals. They are incredibly intelligent. As I mentioned, quite elusive. So if a leopard was being chased by something, what they could occasionally do is they may run away, but then circle around to try and get out of view of whatever it was chasing them, or just find a little spot and hide and literally duck down into a drainage line or into a thicket, hide away, perhaps whatever was chasing them, walk straight past. They're very, very clever cats and so beautiful. It was amazing to see them this morning, and the light at the moment is amazing. Beautiful, beautiful sunrise. It's quite a cold morning in Juma. And let's just have a look around here again. Some more. Tennessee, and she has just sent through a question. Cassie would like to know how long I've been guiding and tracking for, and where I learnt how to do this. I've been in this industry for almost 10 years now, and guided at one specific lodge for about 6 years in the Sabi Sands, just south of here. And an interesting story, but presenter James Henry is one of the reasons I'm here today, and that's because James actually trained me when I started guiding. So if I get anything wrong, it's because of James. we go quite a way back, and we spent many hours in the bush together and learning of the time at the same time, because I think one of the important things in the bush is that you're always learning. It's always going to throw curveballs at you, and you can never guarantee what you're going to see or what you're going to get, as we saw this morning. But as I said, spent a lot of time with James learning, and guided for about 6 years at one lodge, and now traveled most parts of Southern Africa, guiding people from all over the world, which is fantastic, and getting to see different areas. But it's always special to come back to the Sabi Sands and spend time here. I really, really feel that this is one of my favorite parts of Africa. Of being injured. As I mentioned a little bit earlier, happens if, because they're solitary, they cannot hunt for themselves if they get injured. So it's unlikely that a leopard would take on a hyena and fight them. But in saying that, you never know. There's never a set rule in the bush. That's one thing I've learned in my years guiding. You can say one thing and the animals will do something completely different. It's unlikely that they would fight, but if it does happen, the leopard would have to be very careful of the strong, powerful jaws of the hyena. But and one of the benefits or what the leopard would have on his side is the speed, agility, and strength that they have. But it is quite unlikely that they would physically fight. The leopard would probably try and get away, maybe up into the safety of a tree.
Sighting with him. We ended up following the lion tracks very far into Arethusa, and I decided to abandon the mission because we were having broadcast issues from there, so we were getting no signal from this vehicle. So even if we found them, there was a chance that we wouldn't be able to show them with you. So I've decided to head back onto Juma, onto safe ground, and give Byron a hand trying to find what I heard was Tingana. And really interesting that he is pushing deeper into the Juma property. And let's hope Byron manages to relocate him. But even if he doesn't, just that those few glimpses and moments that you shared with Byron and that leopard are so awesome. And it's the quality of the sighting, often more than the quantity or the length of time in a sighting. So really happy about that. I must say, a little bit tricky to leave tracks. We followed them for so far, those lion were moving huge distances. Anyway, at least we are still out here and we could bump into anything else along the way. Driving so quickly after those lion tracks that Phil and myself are frozen from the windshield from the vehicle. We were lucky enough that tracks of the lion were going inside a riverbed, which made them very easy to see, so we could drive very quickly to follow them. Anyway, hopefully the Arethusa guides managed to find them this morning, and at least this afternoon we could possibly head across to try and see them. at the moment and where he last saw Tingana. So we're going to head across into that area and maybe we'll get lucky. So that is our plan for now. This long straight road is the main access road or boundary road. Juma is on the left and Arethusa is on the right. And for those of you who are new to the show, all of these boundaries are essentially invisible boundaries. They are just roads, but the animals can move wherever they like. We, on the other hand, have got more limitations than the animals. But that's a necessity to ensure that everybody driving around these different areas has got not too much traffic or not too many vehicles working any given property. And that is why there are all the various traversing agreements set up between the different lodges, so that you can and do share land or space to traverse, but only up to a degree. Do we have a GPS on the vehicle? Usually I do. I've got an app on my phone that somebody has made that has all the roads of this area, and it marks exactly where you're moving at any given point. And that really makes life easy, much easier than reading a map. But I gave my phone to Byron this morning so that he has access to that GPS, because he hasn't had time to familiarize himself with the roads and the property yet. So he has got an app that works as a GPS on my phone, and it can be really useful even for me. I know all the roads on Juma very well, but sometimes if you are off-roading and following animals through the large and thick blocks, it can be difficult to know exactly where you are or where the closest road is that you may be approaching, and then it becomes very, very useful. So there's, in my mind, nothing wrong with using the technology that is available to us to make our lives easier. I'm going to continue down this long straight road. It's going to be the quickest way to get us into the area of Byron and hopefully Tingana. Failing that, this area we're driving through now is also an area where a female leopard called Shadow and her 8-month-old cub, Sindile, as we, the Wild Earth family, have named him just for the time being until he reaches maturity, and then in all likelihood he'll be named by the guides of this area, but we've just given him our own name for now. Anyway, the two of them, those two leopards, have been spending a lot of time in this area crossing between Arethusa and Juma, so we could bump into them here at any point in time. Updates on the game drive channel to see if anything's going on here. Are there any other updates, guys? Any updates on Vuyatera? Shadow. Just on our right. right-hand side. Difficult to see at the moment, but walking along the road in this area, there have been a few pad marks of what looked to be a female leopard. It is difficult with Shadow and her cub because they are, the tracks are fairly similar in size. And up there you can see two tracks fairly easily, but when the tracks are in the shady areas it can be difficult to pick up all of the finer details of them. Anyway, we're going to carry on, but it's certainly going to, this information is useful for us to put into the memory bank for later, and we'll possibly come back into this area. There have been a lot of vehicles driving around here. There have also been wild dog tracks in the area. So a lot going on in this area. Lions, wild dogs, leopards, a lot of predators on the move. It's just about trying to find them now. To know why we can't follow those lion tracks any further into Arethusa, and we could, but because we don't have much signal there at the moment, the area I was going through, the signal chops and changes on a daily basis. Sadly, this morning it wasn't very good, and I don't want to leave Byron stranded across here having to do the whole drive on his own. And I thought it would be also great to come back and see if we can find Tingana. So like I say, hopefully get an update as to where those lions are found, or if they are found this morning, and we can possibly head across there for the sunset safari later on today. But trust me, it wasn't easy turning around and heading in the opposite directions of those tracks. We followed them from far, from all the way at the Vuyatela camp, which is the camp on Juma. Literally from outside the final control room there were tracks of these lion, and they've come all the way probably about 3 miles where we left them into Arethusa. They've covered a huge distance. Briefly earlier, there were wild dog tracks heading towards Juma from Arethusa, and it was quite funny as I was speeding down one road trying to loop ahead to where I'd find the lion's tracks. They crossed straight across a main road, this main road just further behind us, and I was trying to link ahead to find their tracks on another road, and I saw Sean from Arethusa flying around the corner, and he was like, "What you looking for?" And I was like, "Lion." And he was like, "I'm following tracks of wild dog that had actually been heading in the opposite direction to where I was going." But sadly we didn't bump into them along the way, but at any point in time we could come across those wild dog. They move huge distances in very short spaces of time, which makes tracking them extremely difficult. Often guides, when following tracks of wild dogs, will see the tracks and drive to the opposite end of their property where the tracks are heading towards, just to make sure they haven't already crossed out. So that gives you an idea of how quickly they can move. They can cross through an area without anyone even seeing them, leaving tracks everywhere in and along and in between, which if you try and follow each footprint you'll be there for days. You'll never catch up to them. But hopefully they're going to catch up with us, and like I say, sometimes the animals find us before we can find them, and there's nothing wrong with that. We have to take all the lucky moments we can get out here. Hyena track coming towards us there that I just wanted to double check. Now, anywhere from here where we are now, we could possibly bump into Tingana. I believe he was heading in this general direction, and the amount of time that's passed between when you last saw him with Byron and now would easily have been enough for him to get to here, provided he still is on the move. It's a little female, fully grown, so I should be careful of how I word that. She's a fully grown female, but it's just a very small antelope, the steenbuck. I'm going to try and creep forward a bit. Or is she going to pop back out? No, it looks like she's popping back out. Looks like she can't exactly work out what she wants for breakfast this morning. She's thinking about taking a nibble on those little bushes, but there we go.
Yeah, somebody she was left as well, but it looks like it was just driving around and sleeping around there. I don't know what it was.
Okay, well, I don't know, is it going to pop out again? No. There's too much thick bush, so we're going to carry on. Okay, well, we're very close to Byron now. He's still and he's actually on the same road that we're about to turn onto. I just want to update Aubrey and Texan as to what's going on so that they have a chance of also helping us to relocate on this leopard. And such short spaces of time that it's important to remember when you are looking for an animal or trying to relocate an animal to loop ahead and often try and forecast where the animal's gone rather than looking for each individual track. Towards Philemon's dip and then also Impala where alarm calling somewhere on Philemon's cut line. from Michigan, and Roma's got a really interesting update for us, and that is that she was watching the Arethusa waterhole camera last night, and at around 2:30 there was wild dog and hyena with some kind of a carcass there. Now, I don't know anything about that, even though I bumped into Sean a little bit earlier. Morning, Texan. Texan's also on the hunt for Tingana now, so there's a few vehicles working this area, so really good that we've all teamed together and are trying to find this beautiful male leopard. Anyway, I didn't hear any reports from Sean in Arethusa when I briefly crossed paths with him. Like I said, he was frantically following tracks of wild dogs in the opposite direction that I was following the lion tracks. So I don't have any updates for you there, but if we do hear anything, I'll be sure to let you know what was going on. Really interesting that the wild dog were moving about at night, because if you read in the textbooks, they'll say that they are daytime, diurnal predators, and that they typically don't move around at night. Them and cheetah are both the same. Sorry, I just thought I heard something. False alarm. But hyena, lion, and leopard will be far more comfortable moving around the night than wild dog and cheetah. The fact, though, that the moon is very large, and even though it's not full, if we look at it now, it will show you that it still gives off a lot of light, and that is what would have probably allowed the wild dog to move after dark. So in full moon scenarios, when the moon is very bright like it is at the moment, even though it's not quite full, it's busy waning, so it's getting smaller and smaller. We had full moon about two or three nights ago. This would have provided enough light for the wild dogs to feel safe to move around in, as their nocturnal vision isn't very good. Okay. Well, thanks very much, though, Velma, for sending through that update. And hopefully, those wild dogs will pop up at some stage. They're one of the most awesome animals to follow, especially because we don't get to see them very often. But even if we could see them often, it's so exciting following them. They're incredible hunters and cover huge, huge stretches of territory in search of prey, and will often run their prey down over long distances until they become too tired and cannot run anymore. Thanks very much for sending your question through. I haven't heard your name before on the show, so it could be that you're a new viewer, and if you are, welcome on board with us. Michael would like to know why wild dog are endangered. And for those of you who didn't know that, they are critically endangered. I think there's, I can't remember the numbers of them in the Kruger Park, but there's very few. I think possibly only about 200 or 300 wild dog in the whole of the Kruger National Park, which is a massive ecosystem. But again, I stand to be corrected on those stats. Regardless of how many they are, though, they are endangered. And Michael would like to know why. If they're such successful predators, why are they not doing well? And there's a few contributing factors to that. One of the main ones is that they get rabies, just like domestic dogs. They are susceptible to rabies. And because most parks are surrounded by villages, those villages' dogs may have a rabies outbreak. And when a domestic dog gets rabies, It has the opposite effect to rabies on a wild animal, and this I find really interesting. Rabies will make a domestic tame dog kind of go wild, and when there are no rabies outbreaks, we don't have any dogs coming into the reserve, but as soon as there is a rabies outbreak, we notice that their behavior drives them a little bit crazy, and they come into the park. And when they come into the park, naturally, if a pack of wild dog comes across a domestic dog, they will fight it. So will lion, so will leopard. And that way, lion, leopard, and even wild dog can get the rabies. Now, if one wild dog out of a whole pack gets rabies, because they're such highly social animals with lots of kissing and licking and mouthing, the whole pack will get rabies, and then the whole pack will often die. So rabies is one of the biggest killers of wild dogs. Another obstacle that they face in this day and age is space. Because they do have such big home ranges, they need space to be able to thrive. And a lot of the smaller parks or smaller reserves may not be big enough to accommodate for wild dog. Yet they could be big enough to have lion and leopard and other animals living in them. And these are the smaller fenced-in reserves, which do provide huge, they all collectively add up to create a lot of safe havens for wild animals, but certain wild animals, like wild dogs that need a lot of space, cannot cope in those small areas. So those are a few reasons why they are endangered. And while we've been sitting here, it's been useful for us to just be able to listen to any signs or sounds that the bush may have been telling us. But we haven't heard anything, it's been silent. And what we can do is now, is we'll continue searching and helping Byron to look for Tingana, the male leopard. And for those of you who have just joined, there was a male leopard seen by Byron not so long ago, and he was moving into this general area. So we're going to send you across to Byron and let you know how he's doing, and we'll catch up a little bit later.
Welcome back, everyone. If you've just joined us, we were sitting at the old hyena den this morning, and all of a sudden, well, there was an adult hyena lying outside the den resting, and all of a sudden, a male leopard walked straight into the area. The hyena saw him, got quite interested and curious, stood up, and then chased the leopard off. I think possibly because it was at a den site that the hyena wasn't too happy with having this leopard around. We got a brief view of him walking through the thicket and tried to follow him, but unfortunately we lost him. He moved down into a drainage line. It was very difficult to follow him. We drove through this block and tried to find if we could, or try to see if we could find him again. We came across some giraffe feeding inside this quite a thick area. We heard some impala alarm calling too, so we headed straight to where we heard the impala alarm calls, but still no sign. It's a very, very thick block, and I mentioned earlier, if a leopard doesn't want to be seen, it's not going to be seen. They're incredibly elusive, but what an incredible sighting. For my first drive with all of you, it doesn't get much better than that, does it? As I mentioned, that was a Tingana leopard, which apparently comes from Arethusa, is a dominant male on Arethusa, and doesn't come into this area too often. And an update I got was this could possibly be one of the first times he's been seen on Juma, and my thinking is because he was quite skittish, maybe because he is in a new leopard's territory and almost challenging the male in this area, he is possibly a little bit more nervous and very, very, very wary of where he walks and what he bumps into. And perhaps that is also why he ran so quickly from the hyena. morning here in Juma. It was quite chilly earlier on, but sun's up now, it's starting to warm up. Still a lot of bird activity. Just a great morning being out here. Especially for the new guide in the area, don't forget you can email us on questions@wildearth.tv or alternatively on Twitter, just #SafariLive, and send through your questions, anything you'd like to know, and hopefully I'll be able to answer them for you. We just did one more big loop around the area, having a look if we don't have any sign of that leopard, but we've had no sign. I think he's still possibly in that block and he's hiding from us, or the hyena. Virginia in Kentucky. Virginia has just asked an interesting question. She wanted to know, earlier this morning, while we were sitting at the hyena den, there were some warthog actually coming out of the den. There was a female and two or three youngsters following her out of the den. Virginia wanted to know if the warthog would harm the hyena cubs that are in the den. Virginia, we're not too sure if there are hyena cubs in that den at the moment. There was an adult outside, but there apparently hasn't been any sign of those cubs in that den in the last few days. So possibly the cubs have been moved to another den site. Hyenas do change den sites. And may occasionally have two or three den sites which they move to. Excuse me a second. We've just spotted a little daker. Beautiful, beautiful little antelope. It's a male. You can see those small little horns of his. Just moving around quietly. They generally are quite skittish, the daka. They move off very quickly, very shy little antelope, a little bit larger than the steenbok. We did get a little glimpse of the steenbok this morning running off. Beautiful, beautiful antelope. Quite interesting. There's, I've read up, I've not seen it myself, but I've read and heard from one or two other guides that they have seen daka feeding on carrion or dead meat, even dead birds, which is very interesting for an antelope. Perhaps the reason for that is nutrient deficiency, and they maybe need some additional nutrients in their diet. So and that's possibly why they could do that. He's just moved through the thicket now, and he's disappearing. It's amazing how these animals can all blend in to their surroundings and hide away. And especially these smaller antelope, they've got to be very, very aware, very alert of predators around. So they're very careful. Their sense of hearing is incredible. Their sense of smell is great. And if they do need to get away from anything, they'll run off, and they're so fast and so agile. And that's often why we don't get to see little antelope like these daka. So Virginia, just getting back to your question, I hope I answered it for you. I don't think there are any hyena cubs in that den at the moment, and that's possibly why those warthog were down there. I think it would be highly unlikely for the warthog to go down into a den site if there are hyena cubs around. So I don't think that there's any... here we go, there's a little Stenbok, which I've just spoken about. Let's see if we can get a view of him for you. So, yeah, I don't think there's a chance of that warthog harming the cubs. And if there were any cubs around that area, I don't think that female would allow the warthog to go down into the den. Have a look at that. Just see, there's that little Stenbok, which is a bit smaller than the Dacre. You can see beautiful little antelope. And that's a little female, and that's full grown. A tiny, tiny antelope. Very, very beautiful. See those big ears. And just as I was saying earlier, the ability to hear in these thick areas is crucial. So a lot of these antelope have got great senses of hearing, and they'll listen out for any predators. Another interesting thing with these Stenbok, this is one of the few antelope that mate for life. So they do stay together. They may occasionally be a few meters apart, 50 meters apart, but they'll stay in the same area. And the male and female are always seen together. They'll feed on small shrubs, and as you can see, there we go, browsing little leaves off that shrub. And they are incredibly fast antelope. One of the ways they avoid predators is they will hide in the grass, and you can see their camouflage is fantastic. And they will hide in the grass, lie down, and if a predator walks past, they will shoot up at the last minute and disappear, so the predator doesn't even have a chance to chase them. As I said, this is a little female, and just first off, if you have a look at her, she doesn't have any horns. With these antelope, only the males have horns. Small little horns, very similar to that male Dacre, which we just saw. Tiny straight horns, and you don't see any horns on this one, so you can tell it's a female, especially at this size. This is a full grown. This is an adult. So you would see the horns immediately if it was a male. Sent through a question on Twitter and asked what animal I am most passionate about. Thank you, Molly. It's always a tricky question, I think, because I mean, I'm really passionate about so many different animals, and I think that's part of the reason I do what I do. But if I had to pick one or two, it would be elephant. I absolutely love elephant. They're incredibly intelligent animals, and they can be soft and gentle and very protective and powerful in a matter of seconds. And the other one is a honey badger. Now, you don't get to see honey badgers very often, but they are definitely one of my favorites and one that I'm very passionate about. They're incredibly tenacious little creatures, and but they are very difficult to see. And but yeah, that's definitely, those two would be, I'd say, my favorites and two that I'm very, very passionate about. Lovely little sighting. That's Timbok though. And it's always great to see these smaller antelope moving around and spend time with them and see what they get up to. And occasionally, you know, because they are so small, they're hard to find. So it's wonderful to watch them and see them moving around. And especially to see a dacre and a steenbok so close to each other or just down the road and be able to view both of them. That's really wonderful. What we're going to do is we're going to carry on driving around and see what else we can find. As I mentioned, it's such a beautiful morning at the moment, so I'm sure there's still some animals moving around. It is still quite cool. Good morning, Tony from the Netherlands, all the way from the Netherlands. Tony's question was about the steenbok, which we just saw, and as I mentioned, they do mate for life. And this question is quite interesting. A lot of guests always ask this. What if one of the members of the partnership, the male or female, gets killed? Would the other one move on and find another mate? Yes, Tony, they would. You know, this survival in the bush, the main, or for success, and the main way to survive in the bush is to have offspring and to mate. So the steenbok would definitely look for another mate. You know, there's always a number of steenbok around, and you know, they're not born in a pair. They would have to find each other, so they definitely would find something else. Looks like we've got some tracks on the side here. Can't see too clearly. I'm going to ask Andrew just to maybe see if he can get a little glimpse for us on that side. Just reverse a little bit. I think there's some terror tracks behind me. See what these tracks are, and I'll explain to you. So those are some hyena tracks. Sometimes a little difficult while you're driving to identify tracks correctly, but those are hyena tracks, probably from last night. Looks like one or two that moved along here. Adults, quite a large track. And the easiest way. So I just caught in a bush here. The easiest way to identify a hyena track, or the difference between a hyena track and a cat track, any cat, whether it be lion, leopard, or cheetah, the hyena track, the back pad, so if you had to look, if you could imagine possibly the palm of your hand, the pad of the track, with a hyena, it only has two lobes at the back, so it loops in and loops out. And then with any cat track, they've got three lobes. So it does one, two, and three right at the back.